Welcome, everyone, to Tort Law Education Day. I'm Melissa Bird, the director of the American Museum of Tort Law in Winsted. We are located in the northwest corner of Connecticut. The mission of the American Museum of Tort Law is to educate, inform, and inspire citizens about the many benefits of tort law and the importance of trial by jury. We hope today this virtual event will broaden your appreciation of tort law and encourage thoughtful dialogue. I'd also like to take this opportunity to mention, if you would like a souvenir, which is sure to be a real conversation starter, please go to our museum gift shop, which is also linked to our website, www.tortmuseum.org. I will be your moderator today. I'm really honored. We have a dynamic panel of prestigious speakers who will be presenting today. We have Shane Inspector. He's founding partner of Klein Inspector. Joanne Doroshow, founder and executive director of the Center for Justice and Democracy. Professor Valerie Hans, Cornell Law School. Greg Cafori, partner of Cafori and McDougall. And we will be closing our seminar with a presentation from Ralph Nader. Following each speaker, I will moderate a brief Q&A. Please submit your questions using Zoom's Q&A feature. We want to get as many questions as possible, so please keep them short, sweet, and relevant. Okay, right now, I would like to introduce Shane Inspector. Shane Inspector is a founding partner of Klein Inspector, one of the leading catastrophic injury firms in the United States. He is a member of the Inner Circle of Advocates, whose membership is limited to the top 100 plaintiffs' attorneys in the United States. He has taught law for many years. In this academic year, he is teaching tort and trial courses at UC Hastings, Drexel Klein, and Stanford Law Schools. Welcome, Shannon.
Oh, Melissa, thank you very much. It's a great honor to take part in Tort Law Education Day and be part of this museum and the many important enterprises of Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader is an American hero. He is probably responsible for the saving of more lives and the health of more people than any American in American history. And so I'm deeply honored to be a part of anything that Ralph Nader is a part of. I want to talk to you today briefly about the subject of making America safer through tort litigation. And I come to this as someone who has practiced in the area of tort law, the law of wrongful injury, for the past 38 years, and as someone who has taught tort and trial related classes for the last 23 years. So I feel that I've given a lot of thought to the importance of tort litigation in America and its interrelationship with the safety of all Americans. And specifically, what I want to focus on is the issue of using a tort case, a lawsuit, as a way to make our society safer. I was taught in law school, and the tort law textbook that I use to teach my tort students says that a tort case is almost always limited to a case for money damages to compensate the plaintiff for the harms wrongfully suffered, and in the rare case, to punish the defendant through the payment of money damages, so-called punitive damages. Very rarely is a tort case amenable to equitable relief. There are some such cases, but they are few and they are far between. But what I want to suggest to you is that we trial lawyers, and we lawyers in general, and I mean that whether we are plaintiff's lawyers or whether we are defense lawyers, can use a piece of civil litigation as a method to make our community safer. It's not because we can require a defendant to reform their behavior as part of the case itself, because the laws of our 50 states and our federal system as well don't permit that for the most part. But I mean that with respect to what we can informally, but in a binding manner, effectuate through the settlement of the suit itself. So to take a very simple illustration, if you are plaintiff's counsel involving a case that involves a defective sidewalk where your client allegedly fell and broke their ankle, and if the sidewalk is unrepaired, with client authority, you may demand that the defendant repair the sidewalk as a condition of settlement. And that would be a good thing, wouldn't it? Because while it wouldn't prevent your client's broken ankle and the pain and suffering that he is going through and will go through, it will prevent a future injury. And of course, the tort system is about both compensation and deterrence. And by making the demand that the shopkeeper reform himself and fix his broken sidewalk, we are saving the community from the risk of a future broken ankle or something much worse. The same thing is true with respect to a motorist. If you have a case that involves a motor vehicle accident and the defendant may have caused the accident because they have failing eyesight, you may demand that the defendant pardon me for the technical kerfuffle there for just a moment. You may demand that the defendant get an enhanced prescription, or in the unusual case that the defendant give up their driver's license as a condition of settlement. Now you might say, well, you can't force that upon the defendant, whether it's the shopkeeper or the motorist. But actually, you as a practical matter, it can work out that way, because if you're not willing to settle the case unless the defendant takes these actions, the defendant may be motivated to take the actions because they want to avoid the trial that would eventuate, both with respect to how much money they would have to pay, perhaps extra beyond a monetary settlement, and also the risk of adverse publicity. And carrying that forward to medical malpractice cases, where many injuries and deaths occur as a result of systems failures in hospitals and in doctors' offices. And those of you who are on this call who practice in the area of medical malpractice know that many incidents of medical malpractice can be prevented by doctors and hospitals reforming their practices, reforming the manner in which they administer medications, the manner in which they credential physicians, the manner in which they run their facilities, and the like. And carrying it forward now to defective products. It is a fact, as I think all of you know on this call, that we have an epidemic in the United States of dangerous and defective products, whether they be motor vehicles decades ago that Ralph Nader helped to reform, or more recently, and perhaps now more ominously, in the area of medical devices and in the area of pharmaceuticals. And a conversation with a defendant about improving their product, and again, as a condition of settlement, can often be fruitful. I know many lawyers who have engaged in exactly these types of dialogues with civil defendants through the Civil Defendants Council. Again, be it in the area of products liability, medical malpractice, premises liability, motor vehicle accident litigation, every area of tort. And you would be surprised at how receptive defense counsel and defendants are to that conversation. Why are they receptive? They're receptive because they don't want to have injuries and deaths occurring as a result of their products or their conduct. They don't want to have more lawsuits. They don't want to have the risk of adverse publicity. They don't want to have high insurance rates. And they do think that you may know something about how to minimize the risk that they have because you have seen so many of these types of cases, or so have your colleagues. And so I have found, and others have found, receptivity among defense counsel, not in all cases, but in I would say a majority of cases in my experience, to a conversation about remediation, about making the conduct of the defendant safer going forward. Now, often the defendants want to be sure that you're not going to use this case as a method of bragging about yourself, let's say on your website, about how you got that particular defendant to change their behavior. And so you would have to be receptive, and you should be receptive to agreeing not to publicize the fact that you are the one who achieved this resolution. But I hope you would see that the safety of the community is more important than some credit that you might be able to get publicly. So you're going to find a receptive opponent in many situations. You're going to find a receptive client. The plaintiff is going to be receptive as well. Every plaintiff I've represented in 38 years wants what happened to them to be not repeated with anyone else. So your client is going to be receptive. Now, if you say to the client, you've got a choice between money damages or getting something fixed, I'm not saying clients would choose the latter and not the former. Of course, they have financial needs because of the wrongful injury that they have sustained. But the choice is not that binary. The reality is that the defendants are usually willing, if they're willing to make a change, they're willing to make the change as well as to pay fair money damages. So you don't have to choose one versus the other. And if there are defense counsel who are on this call, and I hope there are some, and I hope there will be some who watch the recording of this, this is something as well that you can achieve. In fact, you can achieve it even more easily than plaintiff's counsel, because you have that direct relationship with the defendant. The defendant trusts you. You've been hired often by an insurance company who wants to minimize risk for obvious reasons. So if you say to your client, the defendant, hey, you got to fix your sidewalk. Hey, you got to go to the eye doctor. Hey, you shouldn't be driving. Hey, you've got to get a new x-ray machine. You got to add a feature to your product to make it safer. You're going to end up having a receptive audience for that proposition as well. And so let's consider for just a moment, who are the beneficiaries of having these kinds of conversations? And I recognize, parenthetically, that a minority of tort cases would be appropriately amenable to these kinds of remediations, because most matters don't involve a systemic problem. Most car accidents don't occur because the defendant has poor eyesight. It occurs because the defendant was momentarily inattentive, right? Most of the time, the shopkeeper will fix the sidewalk themselves without being forced to do it by a lawsuit. But a significant percentage, perhaps 10% of tort actions are appropriate for remediation, especially those that involve a catastrophic injury or a death. So again, who are the beneficiaries of this? Well, obviously the plaintiff is a beneficiary because he has achieved not just money damages, but he has improved society. And that validates his decision to go to a lawyer and to use the civil justice system. The defendant is a winner too, because they've made their community safer. They've made their own conduct safer. They've reduced their risk of future lawsuits. They can also feel somewhat good about the civil justice system. Of course, they don't want to be sued, but they can feel that something decent and good came out of the fact that there was civil litigation. you, the lawyer benefit. You benefit directly, whether you're plaintiff's counsel or defense counsel, in your own professional satisfaction, because now your practice is more than just having money change hands, but it's also about making the community safer. And in the fullness of your practice, the things that will stick to your ribs long after the money that you've made has been spent will be what you have achieved for your community. So you'll feel good about yourself. It's also great for your law firm. It's great for the spirit of your law firm that you're involved in this kind of life-changing and society-changing behavior. And in many cases, you can brag about what you've done. And so in many cases, you can put it on your website and you can advertise it. And it will bring clients to you. So just from the standpoint of the mercenary aspect of practicing law, it is something that will be appealing to people about who you are as a lawyer. And let's consider what else it does. It lifts all lawyers in terms of the public's appreciation of what we do. We trial lawyers have done a horrible job of explaining to people how important our work is. But by talking about how we have effectuated safety improvements in our communities and in our country, we can cause people to understand the importance of tort lawyers in our community. And that will help us stave off efforts legislatively to deform the tort system. It will help us when we go to try to effectuate positive legislative change. And it will lift all boats of all lawyers in relation to the way we are seen by society. And finally, of course, it'll make our cities and towns and states and countries safer. And that is so, so important. When Ralph Nader wrote Unsafe at Any Speed about the Chevrolet Corvair in the 1960s, it was unforeseeable that so many phenomenal improvements would be made through Ralph Nader's work and the work of the people that he inspired. And we're a much safer society in 2022 than we were in 1965. But we can be safer still if tort lawyers, both plaintiff and defendant, would see as an important part of their practice the making of our community safer through effectuating reforms by the litigation of the cases themselves. It requires the lawyer, in some cases, saying, we're not going to settle the case unless you make these improvements, or you make up improvements that we can agree to. But that will work. It has worked. It is working. A final comment before I take some questions. I think that this needs to be part of a broader conversation. I think that we ought to be considering rules of professional conduct that require lawyers in civil litigation to consider the public interest in their exercise of their practice, so long as it is consistent with the interests of their clients. And I've explained to you why it is consistent, and the need for looking at this should be part of the rules of professional conduct. In a similar way, our state rules of civil procedure and our federal rules of civil procedure should have a provision that lawyers in civil litigation should examine how their work can improve public safety in a manner that's consistent with their clients' interests. And this is a topic that we should be educating each other on through legal education. Most states require legal education courses as a condition of maintaining your license. It ought to be part of the legal education system. And it ought to be part of a law school curriculum in torts class. My 1,200-page book ought to include at least a couple of pages that talks about how lawyers can and should effectuate safety changes as part of their practice. Okay, I've spoken long enough. I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay, Shannon, thank you. We do have a few questions for you.
Yes.
The first one is, I saw that you recently co-authored an article titled, It's Time for a Criminal Investigation of Boeing CEOs. Two questions. The first part is, would this be something like a state reckless homicide prosecution, like the Pinto case against Ford Motor Company by the state of Indiana? Or are you thinking it would be a federal criminal prosecution? That's the first part. And then the second is, why is it that tort lawyers are so reluctant to advocate for criminal prosecution of corporations and executives?
Great questions. With respect to Boeing, there should be state-based prosecutions for a level of homicide, and they should come from the states of the seven American victims. That's an important step. With respect to federal jurisdiction, homicide, except in certain limited circumstances, is not a federal crime, but there is a potential claim against the CEOs for defrauding the FDA, which the Department of Justice can bring. Their settlement with Boeing from January of 2017 has been questioned, and that's a mild statement, been questioned by a federal judge as recently as last week, and there may be an opportunity for the federal government to bring a federal fraud charge against the CEOs. On your second question, why are tort lawyers reluctant to advocate for criminal prosecution? The answer is because we believe that DAs are unwilling to bring criminal cases involving torts. The experience with the Ford Pinto case was humbling for lawyers in prosecutors' offices across the country because that case was unsuccessful in Indiana in the 1970s. Ford spent a lot of money and hired very good counsel and won that case. And that sullied interest in bringing these cases. They're extremely expensive. They're very difficult. I had that conversation once on a matter with a DA from a suburban Philadelphia county where I thought he should bring a criminal prosecution. And his answer to me was, that's why the family has you. In other words, they felt that the civil justice system was an adequate substitute for the criminal justice system. And what I'm trying to suggest to people on this call is that the civil justice system is the best protection we have against the free enterprise system, but we need to broaden our own scope within our work to see that we can effectuate change and not just the exchange of money.
Excellent. Are any of the white shoe Wall Street law firms taking plaintiff tort claims?
Are any of the Wall Street white shoe firms taking plaintiff's law claim, plaintiff's tort claims? Well, may I just pause slightly to say that I think I have some law students in my class on this call, and of course, some of them are interviewing with firms like those. And may I just say to law students who may be on this call, that if you're forced to choose between a white shoe and a white hat, choose the white hat. Okay, now that we've gotten through that, to your question, no. The Wall Street white shoe firms don't have white hats because their clients will not hire them if they're bringing tort actions.
Okay. Okay, we also have had a recommendation for the movie Hot Coffee, which is a great movie. And in medical malpractice cases, is there any change after a case has been settled and years later plaintiff has issues directly related to the initial incident, which were not known at the time? Can a lawsuit be brought, especially if that condition affects the patient's life?
Well, I think the writer is asking essentially about our adherence to the United States to what's called the single judgment rule, that you can only bring one lawsuit over your tort, which is the general rule. So if matters get worse after your case is over, you're not going to be able to relitigate those issues. If what you're concerned about is a safety reform, however, I do think that there could be receptivity for the reasons I've discussed.
Okay, great. I think that now I am going to introduce our next speaker, Joanne Doroshow. But thanks so much for your great discussion. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay. Joanne Doroshow is the founder and executive director of the Center for Justice and Democracy and co-founder of Americans for Insurance Reform. She is also adjunct professor at New York Law School, where she teaches civil justice and national advocacy. An attorney Dorsho has worked on civil justice issues since 1986, when she directed an insurance industry and liability project for Ralph Nader. Welcome, Joanne.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me in this great panel discussion today. The person that recommended Hot Coffee, I'm also going to recommend that film, not just because I'm in it, but it's a really great documentary. I'm not sure where to get it right now, but if you have an opportunity to watch it, please do. So I'm going to talk about the issue of tort lawsuits in America, dovetailing off of what Mr. Spector just spoke to all about. This issue does tend to get caught up in a lot of sensationalized rhetoric about litigiousness in America, which is why the Hot Coffee documentary is so revealing to counter some of that. It's certainly involved and gets involved in a lot of political discussion. It's usually part of a very orchestrated campaign, a very insidious campaign by a lot of large corporations, professional trade associations, really any large entity that wants to seek some kind of immunity for themselves, for their members, or to block access to the courts for everyday people who happen to be injured or the families of those who have been killed. Unfortunately, in most of the political discourse about tort lawsuits, you hear very little discussion of the most critical function of it, which is to make us safer, which is why this is such an important panel, and certainly addressed largely by Mr. Spector in the last presentation. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about that today and why it is so important to protect this system. One thing that history has shown us over and over again is that in addition to compensating people, these kinds of lawsuits also deter unsafe corporate practices. They give major industries the financial incentive to become safer, to become more responsible. And in fact, they can lead to very specific safety improvements that benefit large segments of the population. Sometimes, as Mr. Spector just talked about, these are things that are demanded in settlement agreements after somebody has been harmed and does and sues. And just to give you one very straightforward example of how that worked, 2014, a guy named Vernon O'Toole was traveling down a road in North Carolina, and he was rear-ended by a unified tractor-trailer truck. The truck driver had been on his cell phone for 7 hours at that point, and he was already 8.5 hours into his shift. His employer was simply not enforcing cell phone use limits that he was supposed to be complying with. So Vernon was seriously injured. He sued, and there was a settlement. And as part of the settlement, Unified Truck Company agreed not to just limit cell phone use, but to ban it altogether while their trucks were on the road. And of course, that makes us all safer. If you're a motorist driving around large trucks, you know the fear that you might have about distracted driving by these trucks. So this isn't a very important settlement, part of the settlement agreement that we all benefit from. Another very straightforward example. If you've ever wondered why when you are washing clothes and you lift the lid when the washing machine is running, it stops. And when that happens, I want you to think about little 9-year-old Rebecca Newcomb, who before this was standard, these shutoffs were standard in washing machines. She was loading some towels into a washing machine during an agitation cycle, and her arm got pulled in, completely mangled her hand and her arm. 6 unsuccessful surgeries were eventually led to her arm being amputated at the elbow. Her mother sued, and as part of that settlement, the manufacturing company, which supplied all kinds of Westinghouse, Frigidaire washing machines, they agreed to equip all machines, new machines, with a lid safety switch and to provide retrofit equipment for anybody that already had, that had a machine already. So this is how deterrence works with the tort system. And of course it works in other ways as well. Mr. Spector talked about medical malpractice cases. There are a huge number and unacceptable number of medical errors in hospitals today. But there have been some steps, like in the 1980s, there was a large number of injuries and deaths due to problems with surgical anesthesia. And in order to bring their insurance rates down and to reduce these deaths and injuries, the trade association for this profession came up with new protocols, new medical safety procedures, and as a result, injuries and deaths dropped dramatically in that field. There's also been other research on medical malpractice lawsuits and how they influence hospitals. One recent study was done by a UCLA professor, Joanna Schwartz, who interviewed a nationwide group of risk managers, claims managers, quality control people in hospitals. And here's what she found, what the survey found, that over 95% of hospitals in the study incorporated information from each stage of a malpractice suit in their patient safety efforts. And they consider lawsuits a valuable source of information about patient safety. So it's important for them to continue to do that, obviously. In addition, tort suits have another very, very important function, which is to force disclosure of internal information that's really vital to the public health and safety that a lot of times companies do not want out. This disclosure can come from public trials. It can come from evidence collected during pretrial discovery that's eventually released and made public. So let's talk about this in the context of some other cases. Talk about auto safety, for example. In the early 2000s, and even before that, General Motors was manufacturing cars with a very, very dangerous ignition switch defect that caused power loss while you were driving. So imagine cruising down a freeway and suddenly your steering and your brakes deactivate. So there were many, many crashes and as a result of this defect. Millions of cars had this defect. Management knew about it, but it was not until the lawsuit brought by the parents of Brooke Melton, who was tragically killed in one of these crashes, who hired an attorney, Lance Cooper, and he pursued this, hired his own engineer to prove the defect existed because GM denied it and did a whole lot of discovery. And eventually, finally, the company knew the jig was up. They settled the case, publicly confirmed the cover-up, recalled millions of cars, and paid billions in criminal fines. So without that lawsuit and the forcing out of this information, many, many more people would have died. Companies engage in wrongdoing like this. It seems like they're much more concerned about the information getting out oftentimes than the actual judgments to victims. It's common for wrongdoers to want to settle confidentially to keep this kind of information secret. They don't want a public trial. But there's some great examples of victims refusing to settle confidentially. There's a young woman named Eva Rowe in Texas who lost both her parents in a horrible explosion at a BP plant in Texas. 15 workers died, 180 people were injured. And when they sued, they found out that there was managers were willfully withholding information about recurring safety problems at this plant. So for 16 months, BP was pressuring Eva to settle her case confidentiality so that this information was not out. She refused, she wanted the documents out, and she finally got what she wanted. BP eventually settled. As part of that settlement, they were forced to release 7 million documents, confidential documents about this, which, by the way, were shared with the Justice Department, which ultimately brought criminal charges against BP over this. Another recent example concerns the litigation following the incredibly tragic Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting. 26 people were murdered, including 20 first graders. You may have heard about a settlement that happened this year, $73 million against Remington, the makers of the assault weapon. The attorney in this case, Josh Koskoff, in the Koskoff Law Firm in Connecticut, fought for these families to make sure that documents were released as part of that settlement, and that's what they got. They got thousands of pages of documents released, internal documents that Remington did not want out. So, you know, another thing that this case and others also illustrate is the interaction between the criminal justice system and the civil justice system, which one of the questions for our last panelists actually raised. I think it's important to know that throughout history, in many instances, tort cases involving crimes, assaults, violence, hate have been brought. You know, remember the crime victims often, and I'm talking about street violent crime victims, they can face terrible financial burdens, medical costs, mental and emotional healthcare costs, trauma, severe lost quality of life. And the criminal justice system is not designed to compensate them, but the civil justice system is. The criminal justice system also doesn't allow perpetrators to be held directly responsible to the victims, but tort cases can do that. So it's not uncommon for crime victims to file civil cases against perpetrators or responsible third parties, including, for example, those that failed to stop sexual abuse of children. And that reminds me of a case that is currently before the Ohio Supreme Court. It was brought by a young woman named Amanda Brand, who was, as a child, repeatedly raped by a violent pedophile who drugged children, raped girls, and videotaped it. She suffered unimaginable trauma as an adult as a result of this. And she sued, and the jury awarded $20 million in non-economic damages for her. But Ohio caps those kinds of damages at $250,000, which is grossly unfair to victims like her and all victims of tort lawsuits in Ohio and other states that have such similar type caps. She's challenging this cap as unconstitutional, and we'll see what happens with this court. In addition, these kinds of tort suits have been very effectively used against hate crime organizations, cases brought by victims of hate crimes. Civil rights groups often bring these cases. The Southern Poverty Law Center has brought many of them. For example, there was a case, a 16-year-old boy named Jordan Grosvenor, who was of Panamanian and Indian descent, was attacked by a bunch of Imperial Clans of America members during a, quote, white-only recruiting mission at the Meade County Fair in Kentucky. He was brutalized. He was knocked down, repeatedly kicked and beaten, severe injuries. The Southern Poverty Law Center represented him, sued this particular clan organization, jury awarded him $2 million, and it decimated this particular clan group. And there are many, many other examples like this. Now, some may say government regulation, we're talking about corporate abuse, they may say government regulation is enough to hold corporations accountable. Government regulations are doing a good enough job. It's a nice talking point that we hear from the crowd of people that want to limit lawsuits, but you know, I don't really think anybody believes that the government gets it right 100% of the time. So let's talk about, for example, the pharmaceutical industry. In 2009, there was a Supreme Court case called Wyeth versus Levine, where the court had an opportunity to consider whether the Food and Drug Administration was doing a good enough job regulating pharmaceuticals, and therefore you didn't need tort lawsuits and to help do that. And you certainly don't need tort lawsuits to compensate victims of poorly designed pharmaceuticals. The court rejected that, and they said, no, it is critically important that we still have tort lawsuits to complement what the FDA does. They explain that the FDA has limited resources. They have to monitor 11,000 drugs. They can't possibly do that effectively. And tort law, they said, offers an additional and important layer of consumer protection that complements FDA regulation. State tort suits uncover unknown drug hazards and provide incentives for drug manufacturers to disclose safety risks promptly. So in other words, tort lawsuits protect us all, whether or not we go to court. Now, there have been, for almost 50 years, efforts to attack this system. It is an embattled institution. Corporate lobbyists want immunity for their members. They don't want to be sued when they kill and injure people. So they attack the system with so-called tort reform laws. Others call them tort deform laws because they are by no means reforms. They are deforms. I'm just going to call them tort limits for the purpose of this discussion. But what they do is they make it more difficult for injured people to sue. They limit the power of judges and juries to make decisions in tort cases. They take away people's access to the courts. They undermine the constitutional right to jury trial. This is in the Seventh Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, this right to trial by jury in civil cases. You can find it in most state constitutions as well. And that is why many courts have found these laws to be unconstitutional. And we'll see what the Ohio court does. They are anti-victim, they are anti-consumer, they are anti-jury, and they really are anti-American. One common one is what's called caps on non-economic damages, which I referred to a little bit earlier. What are non-economic damages? Well, you know, when you think about it, when a jury awards compensation for economic damages, that includes for medical costs, medical expenses, that money doesn't go to the victim. That goes to the healthcare providers that have to pay for medical care that the patient didn't have before the person was injured. But when a person is seriously injured, the greatest loss is really to their quality of life as a human being. Their right to live on a daily basis, free of physical or mental, emotional injuries that really diminish their capacity to enjoy life. And that is what non-economic damages are. And they go to the very essence of our quality of life. Unfortunately, about half of the states have now capped damages like that as a result of a push by the corporate world or corporate medicine. And politicians have unfortunately succumbed to pressure and passed these kinds of caps. We hope more Supreme Courts find them unconstitutional. We'll see what happens there, but certainly they should be repealed wherever they exist in a state. I want to also talk about a new iteration of tort limits, and it has to do with the bankruptcy system. And it's new, it's a new development, and it's very, very serious. From at least 1971 to the early 2000s, Johnson & Johnson was producing talc powder, knowing that this powder, and we're talking about baby powder, for example, was possibly in some cases was tainted by asbestos. Asbestos is a lethal toxin, and Johnson & Johnson knew about this, told no one about it, didn't tell the public, didn't tell regulators about it. Information about this was eventually released to the public in the course of litigation brought by victims. But rather than face a large number of victims in court, Johnson & Johnson, which is an enormous pharmaceutical company, decided to take advantage of a Texas law that allowed the company to split in two. Basically, one company with all the assets of Johnson & Johnson, and then another company with all the liabilities for the harm they caused by their talc powder. Then the company filed for bankruptcy. The company that had all the liabilities, I should say, filed for bankruptcy. So about 40,000 claims got brought into a bankruptcy proceeding and got dumped there. So that these sick and dying victims completely have lost their right under tort law. They become nothing more than creditors in a bankruptcy proceeding in which a fraudulent bank bankruptcy proceeding. They're fighting for scraps of compensation from a relatively small sum of money that the company has allowed for them. So this is clear abuse of the bankruptcy system. There are bills in Congress to tackle this. Nothing has moved yet. Asbestos companies have also used this tactic. And these companies can't be allowed to get away with this, or everybody's going to start doing it. It's very, very serious. Finally, I want to mention one more issue, which is the issue of forced arbitration. You may have heard about this. It's covered in the Coffey film. These are clauses that are buried in everyday contracts that we all have, bank accounts, credit cards, all of our online purchases. Anytime we're downloading software and we have to click agree, there's an arbitration clause in there. Employment contracts have them now. Nursing home admission forms have them. And they basically say if there's a dispute with the company, you have to resolve your dispute in a secret rigged system that is essentially controlled by the company. You lost your right to go to court. Congress has taken some steps to outlaw these horrible clauses, at least when it comes to sexual assault and harassment cases. They need to do far more than that and outlaw them generally. So we're hoping this will get new consideration at some point in Congress. So to sum up, I think it's really clear we all need the tort system to stay strong. Without these tort lawsuits, there would be far fewer checks on government, on corporate misbehavior. The public would be kept in the dark about much corporate abuse and negligence that goes on. So we have to keep the system as strong as we can. So thank you, and I look forward to any questions you might have.
Slips, trips, and falls are the leading cause of the emergency room visits in the U.S. and is the leading cause of accidental death for the elderly. Yet the public frowns upon slip and fall lawsuits and degrades the slip and fall lawyers who represent the victims. Like in the movie Hot Coffee, the media is a co-conspirator in misinforming the public. How can society be changed to better understand the reality of personal injury litigation?
Boy, this has been a problem for a long time. And I tell you, with social media, I think it's even worse, because you want to click on a headline. There is some, you know, whoever is writing articles about some of these cases are focused on sensationalizing headlines, focusing on the amount of money that's awarded instead of the misconduct or the dangers that lead to the injuries in the first place. So what I always try to do is whenever I see a headline, read more closely what the story is, and then try to publicize the misconduct that led to the judgment, instead of just accepting the way people tend to sensationalize verdicts, settlements, outcomes, which is focusing on the money. I think it does a real disservice to the kinds of lawsuits that get brought and why money does get awarded to victims. You have to be very vigilant in how you respond and publicize things like that. That's the best short advice I can give to people.
Okay, that's great. There are US federal agencies that have been captured by industry and business, and in concert with them, pass laws that make it very difficult to bring tort suits against said agencies. They do this, for example, by limiting the timeframe in which citizens can raise a challenge to a very short period, oftentimes well before damage from the agency's actions can be revealed. Is there any way to break through such an impasse?
Well, you know, we're talking about who controls federal agencies. They're in the executive branch, and Congress can also have a say as to what federal agencies do. So these are political challenges that we all have in trying to influence the way an agency regulates and what kind of laws Congress passes. The only thing you really can do is to stay very engaged, and certainly agencies have opportunities for people to comment to them, to tell them how people feel about things. when certain politicians get into Congress or into the executive branch that are more willing to be sympathetic to victims' rights, those are really times to jump on this and to try to get change within agencies or within laws while there are people that are open to hearing about it. So it's really just a matter of staying engaged civically, and that's the only way change is going to happen.
That's right. Vigilance. How can lawyers balance the need as client advocates to reach quiet settlements with our own obligations to the greater community to get the truth out and deter further harm?
This is a real problem because I know that plaintiffs' lawyers and the victims want the information out, but sometimes the defendant will only settle confidentially. And it's a bit of a dilemma, which is very understandable. Lawyers have an obligation to their clients. And if the defendant refuses to settle other than confidentiality, you have situations that I've talked about here, but it takes, I'll talk about vigilance. Eva Rowe, it took her 16 years to finally get BP to agree not to settle confidentiality. So, this is individual cases, one by one. You're gonna have to make those individual decisions on your own. I'm not sure what can be done as a general matter. Plaintiff's lawyers, expressed to me, look, there's essentially a gun to their head that they are forced to settle confidentially. Now, there have been laws and bills circulating in Congress and at the state level to prohibit confidential settlements where there are health and safety concerns. So there has been some movement on this in the legislative sphere. I think there was a bill in California that would have done that. I'm not sure what happened to that bill this session. There have been bills in Congress to consider doing that. Again, we have to stay vigilant and see whether we can get our state or Congress to do something to prohibit those kinds of settlements where there are at least public health and safety concerns.
Does the attempt by state legislatures to limit the tort settlements monetarily have an adverse effect on bringing tort cases? And what would support making this long-term refocus on the defendants taking corrective practices to promote safe practices?
It is very true that these tort limits, caps on damages, they have proven to not only, for example, I'll talk about the field of medical malpractice where you see a lot of these limits. They not only keep people from getting into court because a lawyer cannot afford to take a case if the damages are too low. These are very, very, very expensive cases to bring, hiring experts and so forth. The attorney has to put money up front. So if there's a cap on damages, this is why these are such insidious laws, because their whole purpose is to keep cases from being brought. There has been some movement to try to lift these caps on damages. It just recently happened in California where damages limit, which had been in effect since the mid-1970s, was finally lifted. So it's better than it was, not perfect, but better than it was. But also look at some of the research that's been done on medical malpractice about the patient safety impact of these, that researchers have found when there are these limits on tort lawsuits, patient safety worsens. People's lives are more at risk. So these kinds of studies are important, and I think they are important to publicize and to push out there that when you do limit people's ability to go to court and hold wrongdoers accountable, defendants, corporate wrongdoers will continue to repeat their recklessness or negligence, and we're all more unsafe, certainly.
Okay. The Connecticut Attorney General is the chief civil rights enforcement law enforcement officer. Does the AG take civil tort cases when it's in the best interest of the citizens?
I don't know the law. I mean, the Attorneys generals are sort of considered the consumer's champion, the people's champion, and they will bring cases under their own particular laws. And I would have to know what the Connecticut laws are to understand what kind of cases the Connecticut AG is able to bring. They tend to bring cases that recover money for the state treasury. So for example, they've been very involved in opioid litigation. They were involved in tobacco litigation, which had put an enormous healthcare burden on state budgets. So they sued to recover some of that money that was expended in the healthcare system. They pulled it out of the tobacco industry. They're pulling it out of the opioid industry to reimburse taxpayers for what they've had to pay out as a result of these public health crises. So I know a little bit more about those kinds of cases, and AGs that take on these huge industries often have to hire outside counsel to assist them, but they have been enormously successful in trying to recoup money for the state.
Okay. I think we probably only have time for a couple of more questions, quick ones. So what's going on in the cases of children suing the government regarding the environment?
Oh, there have been climate suits. I mean, I don't know. I know which case you're talking about. I don't know what's going on with that one particular case, but there has definitely been a movement to try to use tort litigation or litigation generally to change some of the worst offenders when it comes to climate issues, the oil companies and so forth, the fossil fuel industry. I think they're meeting with somewhat mixed results so far, but I'm not an expert on those cases. I think though that they clearly have an important function, if only to help raise attention to the issue, and also they help focus people on the issue of the cost of climate problems. And I think sometimes people may be more interested in that issue than anything. So I don't know, I'm not an expert on all those, but I think they're really, really important cases to bring.
Okay, great. And this will be your last question before we move on to the next speaker. Who enforces non-disclosure agreements?
Well, if there is such an agreement and the defendant believes that they've been breached in some way, then they go to the court and I'm not a litigator, but I assume that gets litigated before a judge and whatever outcome there is. But the defendant who forces a plaintiff to sign one of these wants the information to stay silent. So if there's a breach, they're the ones that are going to go to court to complain about it.
Great. Thank you so much, Joanne. We appreciate all your time and answering all of these questions. Next, I am introducing Professor Valerie Hans. She is the Charles F. Recklin Professor of Law at Cornell Law School, where she conducts empirical studies of law in the courts and is one of the nation's leading authorities on the jury system. Trained as a social scientist, she has carried out extensive research and lectured around the globe on juries and jury reforms, as well as the uses of social science and law. Professor Hans is co-editor of the Journal of Empirical Legal Studies, editor of the Annual Review of Law and Social Science, and past president of the Law and Society Association. Welcome, Valerie.
Thank you so much. I'm gonna share some slides here. So just let me know if you can see them.
Yes, we're good.
Great. Terrific. And thank you so much for that nice introduction, Melissa Bird. It's an honor to be here and to speak at Tort Law Day, and actually to speak after two speakers whose points were fantastic. And I think my presentation, which will focus on how to safeguard the civil jury in tort cases, will build on some of the points that the two speakers made. I want to discuss what to me are some troubling trends in the decline of civil jury trials. I want to talk about what we're losing as a result of this declining presence of civil juries in our tort system, and about how we could all benefit from reinvigorating the institution of the civil jury. The first slide I want to start with, it shows what to me are startling statistics. I mean, if you look at this slide, you'll see a red line and a blue line. The blue line is the percentage of cases, civil cases decided through bench trials, the red line through jury trials, civil trials, since the 1960s. And you see this dramatic decline. In 2019, maybe you can see this on the graph, the percentage of bench trials and jury trials that resolved civil disputes was substantially less than 1%. I use 2019 because that was the last full year that was pre-pandemic. The state court data actually show a very similar pattern, with less than 1% of civil disputes being resolved by civil juries. And it's not just a percentage issue, it's actually numbers of trials. If you look here, also a dramatic decline in the number of civil trials by either bench or jury trials that are heard by each of our federal judges over this time period. And you can see again this really dramatic decline. There are a lot of reasons. Some of the speakers before me touched on them, but there are lots of reasons for this decline in civil juries, and perhaps we can talk about that later. One is cost and expense of mounting a civil jury trial today. The mandatory arbitration agreements that Joanne Doroshow just spoke about, as well the legislative decisions spurred by vigorous lobbying to place limits on what juries can do, in particular the limits on damage awards and non-economic damage awards, punitive damages. And I also want to give some, I don't know if I'd call it credit, to very effective business and insurance company campaigns that have really, I think, helped to, that were critical of civil juries and have really helped to create this kind of culture of mistrust in what civil juries can do. The other thing that we have to talk about is the fact that we are still in a pandemic, and that has had a dramatic impact on what's happening in the courts. I mean, for a whole variety of reasons. When the pandemic first hit us, of course, many courts closed completely. And when they reopened, the presence of the jury was actually a big question mark because, you know, by its very nature, the jury brings people from the community, different parts of the community together to deliberate in a closed space in person. And so that created really substantial challenges in addition to how to mount an effective jury trial when your witnesses are masked and distant and the jurors themselves are really distant. And although courts have reopened and trials are ongoing, there's a huge backlog. And I think many clients simply said, well, you know, we don't want a trial under those circumstances. And that gave a big push to arbitration, mediation, and just lumping it instead of pursuing a jury trial. Well, I think we're losing a lot by this decline in civil juries resolving our disputes. And I want to talk a bit about what, on the basis of research that I have done and other jury researchers and scholars have done, what exactly it is we are losing. First of all, both Ms. Doroshow and Mr. Spector discussed how tort litigation can make our community safer. And they talked about both both trials and also settlements as vehicles for this safer world and individuals whose harmful behavior is deterred, but I would argue that it is stronger in a transparent public trial where evidence is out there for all to see. And people from both sides can present evidence about the causes of plaintiff injuries, and the community has a role in resolving that particular civil dispute. A representative jury, in particular, one that does accurately and fully represent our community, is, I will argue, an especially strong fact finder because of its ability to draw on different perspectives on issues often very relevant to a civil litigation. It also, the civil jury is also an amazing vehicle for education. I mean, civil jurors are sitting there looking at, you know, how law is applied, what the law is, and how courts function in this important branch of our government. Alexis de Tocqueville, a French thinker, famously said that the jury, in particular, the civil jury, is an ever-open public school that tells people about law. But in addition to just telling us about the law through the vehicle of the civil jury, it also lets citizens engage in self-governance through participation in this important government function. And one of the things we have learned through research is when jurors do this, they actually are more likely to be engaged in other ways in the government, in particular, voting. So let me talk a little bit about the fact-finding information or the fact-finding research and what we've learned through research about the benefits of civil juries in fact finding. I mean, it might surprise you to kind of learn that actually civil jurors have some fact finding advantages, even in contrast to professional judges. I mean, you know, professional judges are great. They have plenty of legal education. They have lots of experience. And have to write their opinions. Those opinions in written form can be challenged. So there's lots to like about having a professional judge as part of the decision-making body. But you know, the experience and kind of legal perspective and the elitism of professional judges means that they are not as informed as a representative jury would be about norms. And norms are extraordinarily important as we think about, you know, how to assess responsibility for a defendant, how do we evaluate the severity of an injury of a plaintiff, how to put a dollar award on that. I mean, so a civil jury in a trial that is presided over by a professional judge is a ideal combination. You have the legal expertise of the judge combined with a body that is able to draw on information and perspectives from the community to resolve a dispute. And it's not just the individual perspectives, of course. Unlike judges, the trial judges, the jurors themselves must deliberate. And deliberation has, through research, been shown to be a very effective vehicle for testing people's interpretations of the evidence, streamlining and clarifying issues in the trial, so that the jury puts together all the information and arrives at a sound collective judgment. A lot of people wonder, like, how could jurors arrive at a damage award? Because, you know, in many places, they're not even given recommendations about how much a damage award should be. So I've been studying damage awards with the help of the National Science Foundation, thank you, for a number of years. And one of the things that my collaborators and I have learned is that damage awards are actually, perhaps surprisingly, show a fair amount of regularity. So if you look at the severity of an injury suffered by a plaintiff or a group of plaintiffs, that's often commensurate with the damage award, so that low or modest injuries typically result in low or modest awards, and more severe injuries are associated with higher awards. non-economic damages closely related to economic damages. Punitive damages, in the rare instances when they are given, are also strongly related to the compensatory damages. So there's a lot of regularity present in the awards that juries actually give. So the interesting thing about research is, and I say when I first started studying juries, I thought, well, you know, what a vehicle for, you know, bias and prejudice and everything. But jurors kind of rise to the occasion. Again, having the opportunity to deliberate with people, perhaps people whose biases are different from those that an individual juror would bring, seems also to function very well to produce sound collective judgments. The research studies have been done show that most judges presiding over civil jury trials agree with jury verdicts. And again, that the damage awards are roughly comparable to and commensurate with the injury. But, you know, the fact-finding benefits of juries is key and important, but it's really not all. Having civil juries also increases the perceived legitimacy of a verdict, especially in instances where you might have a racially charged case. Having a diverse representative jury can reassure people that different perspectives were considered in the evaluation of an award. A lot of jurors, even though they might resist serving on juries initially, wind up actually afterwards becoming more favorable to the courts. After all, they've had a front row seat and they themselves have participated in the process of decision making. So their regard seems to increase. There are clear educational benefits to participating and also civic engagement benefits. One of my favorite studies is by John Gastel, the deliberative democracy researcher, and his collaborators, who examined jury service and voting records for over 13,000 jurors across the United States, both civil and criminal. And in criminal cases, especially people who had not been very frequent voters in the past, tended to really get a civic engagement boost from participating as a juror. In other words, one form of civic participation encouraged another form of civic engagement. In a project I did with John Gastel and one of his grad students, we found similar kinds of patterns in civil juries. We also found bigger boosts in what I would call the traditional jury, a jury of 12, a jury that had to reach unanimity. Those individuals were especially more likely to vote in the following election. So my argument, it really builds on Mr. Spector and Ms. Doroshow's arguments in the past. I think trial by jury in tort cases really strengthens our democracy in a whole variety of ways. We've got the benefit of transparent and public proceedings combined with outcomes that are able to reflect the community's view. We also have a vehicle that's an educational device and one that helps to cement some of the important practices and values of self-governance in a democracy. So how do we go about reinvigorating the institution of the civil jury? I've co-authored a paper that I encourage you all to read by Richard Jolly and Bob Peck. The link should go in the chat shortly if it hasn't already. We called it Democratic Renewal and the Civil Jury, and it's forthcoming at the Georgia Law Review. In it, we look at two different sets of possibilities, of possible ways to increase and reinvigorate our civil jury. Do something that actually has been in play or undo something that's been in place since 1938, that this could be an uphill battle. Some of you might know that if you want a civil jury in the federal courts or in all but, I think it's 5 state courts, within a very short period of time after filing a lawsuit, you've got to request a civil jury. So the default is no jury. All right. And we say that's bad symbolically. And it's bad because it probably, especially for people who are not very familiar with the civil justice system, it kind of eliminates the possibility of them to have a jury trial. So we say default the other way. The default should be for a civil jury, not against a civil jury. Ms. Darsho spoke really powerfully about the problems of damage award caps and the ways in which it makes, you know, very expensive to produce cases like Med Mal cases not feasible for attorneys, leaving a number of plaintiffs unable to find somebody to represent them to bring their cases. And we also think we might, because of the time and expense for full jury trials, we might explore some options, such as summary jury trials or virtual jury trials, but making sure that we keep the elements of jury trial, civil jury trial, that are key. And in particular, a substantial number, 12 people, we recommend for any of these procedural innovations. In addition, juries do a good job. That's what all the research says, but there are challenging cases out there. So how can we maximize accurate fact finding that reflects the community's judgment? Number one, make sure that all of our jurisdictions across the country do a good job and use best practices in trying to seat a representative cross-section of the community. That is also best accomplished. A representative jury is best accomplished with larger juries, 12-person juries. And we also recommend what we call active jury reforms. Some of the procedures and jury trials, you know, they're centuries old and people can read and write now. And why not let them take notes? Perhaps discuss cases as they are going on in case questions arise. Pose questions that the lawyers and judge can review so that jurors are making decisions based on accurate and clear understanding of the evidence. So I look forward to your comments. And if you'd like to contact me, here's my contact information. And thank you for the little hands up. I appreciate that.
Thanks so much, Valerie. We have a couple questions. Home foreclosures never go to trial in Connecticut. How does Connecticut Housing Finance Authority, a quasi-public agency, get jurisdiction to foreclose without trial on thousands of homeowners who use the CHFA, First-Time Homebuyer Down Payment Assistance Program, but pass off the loan servicing to private banks?
Yeah, I really have no way of answering that question. It sounds like a really serious problem, though, and one where you would imagine being able to enlist our tools in the civil justice system, and perhaps including civil juries, would be most significant and most important. So thanks for the question. Perhaps some of the other speakers would be better positioned to answer it.
Okay. We have lawyers for both plaintiffs and defendants often feel that a juror does not have sufficient information or the background to understand a case. For example, in medical malpractice, if the juror can't see the outcome of an insult visibly, they may not give a fair award. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I think our idea of trying to maximize the recommendations that Richard Jolly, Bob Peck, and I suggest to try to maximize accurate and fair decision making on the parts of juries really kind of address what happens when juries are presented with really complex information. I mean, how do they manage it? Giving people the tools to understand complicated medical information might allow them to better understand the severity of an injury. But you're quite right that attorneys are really in a challenging position when the injury is not able to be seen. I've tried to explore some of the ways that people might make sense of hidden injuries. For example, whiplash, right? Anybody who has suffered a migraine, which is absolutely invisible, but can be extraordinarily painful, would appreciate how some injuries can be hidden and yet also very, very severe. So one of the techniques that an attorney might use is to think of injuries that are hidden, but yet can be absolutely disabling for anybody who suffers them. So that is one thing. I think the other thing about so-called hidden injuries is there is incredible attention then on the credibility of the plaintiff on the part of jurors. And so if you are thinking about and how to present a lawsuit, ways that you can maximize the credibility of the plaintiff will then make it less likely that jurors might fall into that trope of, oh, you know, they're just faking an injury, you know, to get money, and the sort of money hungry plaintiff trope, and instead be convinced that, oh, here's a person who's honestly suffering and we're hearing about it. And it also shows the need not only to rely on the plaintiff for describing the injury, but also any corroboration is going to be even more significant, even more important.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah.
Are there any studies demonstrating a link between people serving on a jury and how likely they are to file a tort case in the future?
No, I don't think so. That's such a fascinating question. You know, people come away from jury service not only more likely to vote and engage in the world around them, the social world, the political world around them, but also with more respect for the courts, more views that what happens in court actually is fair, is just. And so if I had to hypothesize, I would say it could well be that if somebody had an injury, they might look more favorably and more positively on the courts as a way to resolve those types of injuries. I can't think of any project that actually looks at it though. Yeah, good question.
We also have, are there practices of jury trial in other countries, example, Norway, that we might learn from in the US?
You know, so one of the things that I have recently been doing is looking at how lay people are used in legal decision-making roles in other countries. So I'm currently right now examining how many other countries use civil juries. The best I can estimate, about 20 jurisdictions worldwide use civil juries. So it's not a major way of resolving civil disputes elsewhere in the world. But very frequently, there are mixed courts in other countries that resolve civil disputes. So that would include a professional judge combined with lay people chosen in a variety of ways to address civil disputes. And I think, you know, there's always the worry that the professional judge will dominate that decision-making body. I mean, we kind of protect our jurors, right, from that by making them decide separately. And then, you know, obviously following the judicial discussion of the law and presentation of the law, but nonetheless, making their decision separately and then bringing it back to the judge. But in a mixed court, you have a deliberation that combines both professional and lay judges. So, you know, there's a mutual influence to be sure, but possibly greater influence of the professional judge. So I found that interesting that a very significant number of countries use lay people, see the value of using lay people and resolving disputes worldwide. So it's not just us. And some of these mixed courts actually have people, require people to have particular types of expertise that so they can help the judge as well as the judge helping them with the law.
Okay, great. We have time for one more question. And would you share your thoughts on televised and live stream trials?
I am eager to see more televised trials, live stream trials. I think if juries and viewing jury trials is limited to courtrooms, only a modest small number of people would see them, and then we learn about those trials through reporters and others who were there, who share their own perspectives, but it's colored by, influenced by their own perspectives. So the idea of televising trials or live streaming trials brings it to a broader audience. We saw that vividly in the pandemic when several courts, I'm thinking of Texas in particular, started live streaming procedures, and the amount of the number of people who wound up being able to actually see justice in action really skyrocketed. So I think if you think about why do we have jury trials, as a way of a community expression and involving people and wanting people to see justice done, that's one of the benefits of televising trials. I wish more courts did it. Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks so much. All right. Well, thank you for sharing, Valerie. We appreciate. Our next speaker is Greg Cafori. Greg Cafori is a founding partner at Cafori McDougall, and over his 40-year legal career, he has tried hundreds of cases. Long a leader in Oregon's progressive community, he has won verdicts for activists, whistleblowers, and victims of police brutality, totaling more than $21 million. Greg has also had 14 jury verdicts of 1 million or more, the most in the history of Oregon. Welcome, Greg.
Thank you. I've been practicing law for 48 years, the last 25 with my partner, Mark McDougall, the last 14 years with my son, Jason. We're the three trial lawyers in the firm. We have 10 staff, and we go to trial about 7 times a year, which is a lot. When we have a major verdict, and one that has a public interest, we do not want somebody else to control the narrative. So we put out videos, deposition excerpts, trial excerpts, photos, a press release, and with the push of a button, we can send that to 500 different media outlets. I think it's important that lawyers make use of the press. Far too many lawyers are afraid of the press. They don't see reporters as our natural allies, and of course they are, because we have the stories, and they are, they're not in journalism to make money. They're because they like the stories. So that's one of my messages to my fellow attorneys out there. I want to describe what it's like to have an independent law practice like we have. People who have power in society or seem to have power in society often really don't. They are constrained in all manner of ways. You know, the CEO of a great corporation is always, one change in the wind away from being unhorsed. Congress members are constantly on the phone trying to raise money. They're surrounded by lobbyists. They're reading polls all the time. But private attorneys have a unique combination of both power and independence. Who else has that? We have the power to file lawsuits. We get to some large extent pick our enemies. We have the power to compel production of documents, to compel testimony, these are great powers when joined with the independence of being in a position where nobody can yank your chain, nobody can lean on you. It's a great role, a vital role in a free society. The history of our firm also illustrates that the idea that government agencies are going to be capable of protecting us is a fallacy. What we see in our experience is that government agencies rarely exercise even real power or independence. So some stories. Robert Treblehorn at 47 was on the second story walkway at Wimbledon Apartments when the walkway collapsed underneath him. Wimbledon had 55 buildings, 600 apartment units. And to look at the place, it looked great. You had to do a real inspection to realize that major support elements were rotten wood everywhere. The workers had been instructed to paint over rotten wood, to paint over the steel frameworks of stairways. We had a fire marshal who came by and looked at the place, inspected it. And he said, this place is unfit for human habitation. It is so dangerous. He said, but you know, I can't shut the place down because if I do, we're gonna be throwing hundreds of people into the street. He was able to impose a fine of a few thousand dollars, which was cut in half by his superiors. And that was the extent of what government agencies were willing to do about the 600 units at Wimbledon. This place is owned by Prime Realty, which is a $9 billion corporation owned by two married couples in Los Angeles. We brought suit for Mr. Treblehorn's ruined knee. We had workers who'd been there, workers who were still there, willing to testify against their boss. You can imagine that. And people saying, you know, I live there and the place is dangerous. And yet, you know, I'm being told to cover up safety risks. The company offered $1.2 million to our client to settle the case. And he said, no, I want this on the public record. The jury awarded $20 million in punitive damages. And after that, Prime brought in big, heavy equipment, and the repairs began. The tenants formed a union, and the story went around the country. The tenants around the country were given a message on their own power, and landlords were given a message that they can be heard. So one of the highlights of the case was a trial. I said, well, a lot of these apartments have decks, and they are set out on the outside of the building. I said, suppose you had 10 people on a hot day on one of these decks on the third floor, and it collapsed because so much of the wood was rotten. And the objection was, well, that's a hypothetical question. It's all right. What's underneath the third floor deck? It's, well, the second floor deck. What's underneath the second floor deck? The first floor deck. Inspectors looked at one of the third floor decks. They said, we can't understand why this thing hasn't already collapsed. Interesting case. The another case I want to tell you about, Pamela Settlegood was a teacher in 1998 in the Portland Public Schools here in Oregon. And her job was to travel to various schools and teach physical education to severely handicapped kids. She found that the equipment that was set aside for these kids was either missing or broken. The facilities were so inadequate, she would be bumped for the dance team. She wound up teaching classes in the hall. She reported to her boss at the administration building, who will change the subject. She started writing memos about how bad things were, first to her boss, then to her boss's boss, and up finally to the superintendent. She was, of course, fired at the end of the first year. We brought a lawsuit saying that she'd been fired for improper purposes, including her First Amendment rights to advocate for the federally guaranteed rights of her students. Our first exhibit was a memo sent to her, which instructed her to stop writing memos. And the key language in it said, writing is not an effective means of communication. That was in writing, and that was our first exhibit. I was given a chance by the federal judge to ask just one question to the prospective jurors. And I said, our client was trying to advocate for the rights of severely handicapped children. As a teacher, she was told to stop being an advocate. She refused, and she insisted on continuing to complain. So the school district papered her file and fired her. Now, there may be some who will say, you know, Mr. Kefouri, I don't need to hear your evidence. I just know that's not the way the world works. So if any of you feel that way, please tell me now. And nobody raised their hand. The jury awarded the prayer. A magistrate took the verdict away, wrote a 67-page opinion, 63 of which was describing my alleged misconduct during final argument. And we appealed to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, which said with regard to my misconduct, quote, we find none, and reinstated the verdict and attorney fees, and wrote such a ringing endorsement of the laws supporting the rights of handicapped students that now, 25 years later, that opinion, the Settlegood versus School District, is widely used by lawyers who specialize in enforcing the rights of disabled and special students around the country. The two superiors who oppressed her were fired after the verdict. And so I was able to report to the press that I said, the message of this case is that if you think, if you're an executive in a school district and you're considering firing a teacher for advocating for the students, you should consider the possibility that the career that you destroy will be your own. Rocky Tahara was a client when top lawyers in Hawaii would not take his case. And a fellow named Jay Friedheim, a friend of Mark McDougall since Tulane Law School, invited Mark and me to come there some 20 years ago. Bruce Perry was a guy who, when he walked the docks at Honolulu, the other longshoremen would step aside. One reason was because he was reputed to be the toughest guy on the docks. And the other was that his father was reported by the papers to be the godfather of the Hawaiian mafia. There was a practice engaged in by those who were favored by the union, which was these guys would show up for work in the day, they'd sign in and then they'd take off, go do whatever they wanted. This was called running away. And Perry, of course, engaged in this constantly. And finally, Rocky Tahara, a fellow longshoreman, reported this to the company, which was immediately leaked to Perry. And Perry confronted Rocky at the change of shift in the parking lot, hundreds of witnesses. He sucker punched him. And when Rocky awoke in the hospital, he had a fractured skull, numerous fractures. He'd lost vision in an eye. There are a couple of detectives who were very strong on the case, and they got Perry charged with attempted murder. There were two jury trials, and on both occasions, one juror held out, hung the jury, and Perry walked free. Meanwhile, Rocky had spent years on the mainland in witness protection. But after the acquittal of the dropping of charges against Bruce Perry, he came back, reclaimed his job, and we filed the lawsuit. We took it to a jury, and they awarded several million dollars. Rather than stay and have his wage garnished, Perry left the docks. Other longshoremen came out in support of Rocky Tahara, and the practice of running away came to an end. One of the columnists at the Oregonian wrote, Greg Kefouri and Mark McDougall helped change a corrupt system on Honolulu's waterfront. But true though it was, the real hero of the story, of course, was Rocky. Rashika Herring was a single mom, 26 years old. Her son found her unconscious one morning. She had internal bleeding. Called 911. The ambulance, American Medical Response, came, and she awoke in the back of the ambulance being sexually molested by a guy named Lanny Hazard, an EMT. When they got to the hospital, she made such a scene that the nurse, who insisted that she didn't know what she was talking about, the nurse threatened to call security on her. She wouldn't shut up. And security came, and they were so intimidated at this 5-foot-tall woman who was very upset that they wouldn't come in the room. Finally, head nurse arrived, shooed everybody out, and listened to her. The police came, and they said, well, you know, it's not that we don't believe you, but we can't do anything about this because he's, you know, it's his word against yours. So she came to, she called me the Monday following the Saturday event. And I said, come on tomorrow at 10 o'clock and we'll talk about it. That night I went home and looked at the evening news, and it was announced that Hazard had been arrested because one of the officers had looked his name up in the big computer. Even though he had no record, his name came up in an almost identical incident from several months earlier. So we then put together a boiler room of law students making phone calls to the 500 women who'd been transported by Perry in the previous years. And most of them had no memory, but they were instructed to simply ask, did anything unusual happen in your transport? And we wound up with 17 clients. All those cases eventually settled. And so we became the go-to guys for medical sex abuse in Oregon. In the next few years, Rashika's case, she won several million dollars. In the next few years, there was an extraordinary pattern which unveiled itself. It was always the same. Someone would be arrested, a doctor, a male nurse, a tech at a hospital or care home, and the pattern was always the same. Patients would have complained about being sexually abused, and they were ignored or blown off. Their complaints were concealed, and the human resources and risk managers at the institutions were solely dedicated toward protecting the company. And they saw people who complained, you know, you're complaining, you're the problem, and that was the focus of their attention, not the fact that they had a predator on their staff. So eventually, you know, the predator would go too far, get arrested. And then we, because of our position in this debate, got these cases. And over the course of the next several years, we had about 60 individual cases. We took down basically every major hospital chain in Oregon because the pattern was the same every single time. And some of these cases went to trial. We prevailed, most of them settled. And now, as a result of these cases, and these are enormously expensive, you know, you get 10, 12 of these cases from one hospital, they're enormously expensive at the hospital. Things have now changed. We don't get these calls anymore. And the only explanation that I can make is that the risk management types and the human resource types have finally learned that they need to take these kinds of complaints seriously. Time perhaps for one or two more cases. Lloyd Clark Pipeline Company, 6 years ago, had its heavy equipment out digging a hole in a sidewalk in a heavily trafficked area of Portland. They hit a gas line, and the resulting explosion and fireball caused $17 million worth of property damage, badly injured nine firemen, and police officers. We had two clients emerge from the explosion. One was a gas worker who arrived at the scene to try and prevent the explosion. Another was a gal in a nearby building which was completely destroyed, and she'd been in that building just a few minutes before working as a hairdresser. We had a national expert who came and testified about the errors that the workers made, starting with not following a checklist. So one of the jurors later said, you know, I have to follow a checklist very precisely, and I'm not handling anything dangerous. There were paint markings on the sidewalk indicating that there was a gas line underneath. They had four workers who didn't see it. They cut corners left and right. The expert said that that he'd seen, he'd investigated 1,000 incidents, and this was in the handful of top ones in terms of the number and the gravity of the mistakes that were made. My clients turned down a total of $1 million before the trial, and 3 weeks ago, the jury returned a verdict of $10.4 million. This as well was widely publicized. My clients wanted to make sure that what the pipeline company had done, Loy Clark Pipeline Company, was on the public record. It's a large company, works throughout the West, and now it is on the public record. The Public Utility Commission in Portland, or in Oregon, is charged with regulating these kinds of operations, underwater, underground lines and this sort of thing. They investigated Loy Clark. They knew everything that that we learned in the course of our litigation. They imposed a fine of $1,000 on the pipeline company, $1,000 suspended. That's why jury trials matter. Jonah Johansson was a toddler when some 20 years ago, his brother was suffering from a respiratory illness, as was he. His parents bought a humidifier made by a CAS corporation, which makes 80% of the humidifiers in the world, marketed under the Vicks label. And the parents very carefully read the box, and it said, put this on the floor, pour the water in, plug it in. They did, and his mother was responding to his little brother, who was crying at night, and she went in to check on him. Jonah, about 18 months old, wandered in behind mom, saw the steam coming up from the humidifier on the floor, and reached out to touch it. Toddlers cannot respond to pain very quickly, so his fingers were very profoundly damaged. It's called a 40% full human disability. We took that case, and CAS had been in business for 80 years, and we went to the Consumer Product Safety Commission. They had lots of reports of injury, but we were not allowed under federal law to learn who had made these complaints. They had all this evidence, but it was useless, I say, to litigants. Your government at work. So we prepared for jury trial. Our engineer took a look at the design of this machine, which had been unchanged in 80 years. And literally on the back of an envelope, he said, here's three ways this could be redesigned so that the steam comes out much, much cooler. And people don't get burned. Just before trial, we learned that in fact, one of those changes had been made. And instead of the steam coming out at 155 degrees, it was, or at 212 degrees, it was now coming out at 155, a vastly safer operation. The fact that the correction was made after 80 years, I can only attribute to the fact that we had a very large punitive damage prayer and a high profile case. The case settled while the jury was out because the reform had already been made, and it was simply a matter of compensation. But one other tale of just what you know, what actually bringing lawsuits, what the threats of lawsuits can do, and what verdicts can do. another case from about a month ago. We've had 4 major jury trials in the last 2.5 months. So we go to trial more than most people do. Michael Mangum was in the Walmart, and he's a guy who does works with the kids at the projects who are in danger of wasted lives, in danger of joining gangs and so on. He spends his time with these kids, steer them in the right direction. He's in Walmart, he's looking at light bulbs, and he's being watched by the loss prevention guy, a guy named Joe Williams. So he protests, he says, look, you're looking at me because I'm black, and who's gonna steal light bulbs? So they go back and forth. He's ordered by Williams to get out. He says, I didn't do anything wrong, I'm not leaving. Williams says, I want to call the police. He said, go ahead. Williams calls the police. He says, there's this guy who won't leave. And then when the police get there, Williams' allegations escalate. And he's saying, yeah, and he threatened to smash me in the face. Well, the police don't believe him because Williams has a history of calling the police and lying, summoning them and saying there's violence at the scene. They have to hurry, and they go flying there, running red lights with their sirens going, and finding out that there's no violence at all. So they said, well, now we're not going to do anything to this guy. So my guy's able to leave. We sued because he was deeply upset at having been targeted for his race. And, you know, this happens a lot. We do a lot of shopping while Black cases. We sued Walmart. And in the course of that litigation, we learned not only that the police had sent a message before this incident to the people who ran the Walmart store that they didn't believe a word that Joe Williams said, but after this event, Williams called the sheriff's office and said, somebody better come down here and explain why you guys didn't do what I told you to do and throw this guy out. The sheriff came. Sheriff came and told the top two people at the store that that this Williams guy was a menace because he was making false reports, getting the police to arrive anticipating violence, which carries all kinds of risk. And after that, he stayed on the job. Nothing happened. The jury awarded $400,000 in compensation to my client, $4 million in punitive damages. And that story went around the world because Walmart is everywhere. And resistance to Walmart is everywhere. So I would hope that stores everywhere got the message that when you hire people who have the power to arrest people, to watch people, to detain people, to testify against people, that if they're not honest, you better do something about it. Happy to take any questions.
Thanks so much, Greg.
Oh boy. I think I hit the wrong thing here.
I was just hiding for a minute. I've got a question here. How do you handle redress from discrimination and loss of quality of life when litigating cases?
I talk about the arc of one's life. One's life is in a certain direction. When something happens which knocks them off the rails, the arc of their life is changed. And that's a serious thing. When in dealing with, like in the cases involving my clients who were damaged by the explosion, where they had inner ear injuries, post-traumatic stress disorder, I said, listen, you know, you don't see these kinds of injuries. But with post-traumatic stress disorder, I said, we've all been to the Crooked River where you can stop by the highway and there's a 4-foot stone and concrete barrier. You can look over it. You can look down 1,000 feet. And most people can't do it for more than a few seconds. It's very unnerving. It's very frightening. And that's what PTSD is. You know intellectually that you're safe, just like when you're looking over the 4-foot wall. But still, something inside you gets very, very, very agitated, and you feel very, very unsafe, and you can't control it. So imagine having a life where it's like that all the time, and then it's worse when certain things trigger you, certain things which remind you of the trauma. So there are various ways to explain how one's inner life can be badly altered by a traumatic event.
Yeah, absolutely. We have a comment here that says, fascinating cases. Why does your firm go to trial so often?
We go to trial so often because after all these years, we're finally good at it. And I had one great lawyer tell me he'd never gone to trial when there was more than $100,000 on the table. And we've gone to trial many times with $1 million on the table. And so far we haven't regretted it. And I dread the day when we do.
Have your suits on dealing with police brutality resulted in any changes in how the Portland Police Department operates?
We have the largest verdict against the Portland police for brutality. We have the third largest verdict. We have the fifth largest verdict. And my son has been highly active. My son, Jason, highly active in working on police reform. And he spearheaded an initiative, a city initiative, which passed a hoot and a holler to establish in the next year or so, when it's finally set up, will be the strongest police review board in the country, with the power to investigate, with staff, and with the power to fire cops. And that's unique.
Are we losing ground in tort law as we are with civil rights?
As the professor said, the number of jury trials is diminishing, both in absolute numbers and in percentages. And that is an enormous loss. I tell jurors when the jurors are being selected, I say, if you're selected for this jury, I promise you, you will look back on this as one of the great experiences of your life. And then we talk to jurors. Judges usually let us talk to jurors after a trial. And people routinely say that. They say, this has been a fabulous experience. I'm so glad that I was there. We talk about the history of jury, going back to the Greeks, going back to the 2,500 year struggle to recapture, to reclaim, to defend the rights and powers of the jury against those powerful institutions, which have always sought to take away such power from mere citizens. And it's an inspiring story. Needs to be more widely told. That's why I do shows like this.
That's great. We have quite a few comments. Thank you for the empowering message. Thank you for helping me to believe in white males again.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Would you tell law students to become trial lawyers?
Absolutely. It's the most wonderful role in the world. You have independence and you have power. Who else has that? It's the greatest role in the society.
And I think we have time for one more. Have tort suits improved the safety of college and high school sports?
Oh, absolutely. They've led to the concussion protocols. They've led to safer helmets. They've led to safer equipment. They've led to coaches, at every level, learning that they have legal obligations to protect their kids. And if somebody's not sure who the president is, you get him out of the game.
That's right. All right, well, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right.
Our next speaker, it is a privilege for me to present one of America's finest crusaders. It's Ralph Nader, who is an activist, an author, a lecturer, and an attorney. He has founded dozens of organizations, including Public Citizen, the Center for Auto Safety, the Center for Study of Responsive Law, and the American Museum of Tort Law. He has also played a pivotal role in advancing auto safety, consumer and environmental protection laws, and the Atlantic magazine has recognized him as one of the 100 most influential figures in American history. Welcome, Ralph.
You're not likely to hear what you heard today on NPR or PBS or even read about it in the newspapers. That's what's remarkable about the way our society has ignored publicizing and educating the public about the civil justice system and the law of torts. And it's good to recognize that torts, that's a French word, which means wrongful injury. Torts are everywhere, every day. Crashes on the highway, toxic chemicals in the environment. You just heard some examples by Greg. Construction collapses, the tobacco carcinogenic industry, asbestos, which killed probably 300,000 Americans, mostly workers, since World War II. You have unsafe products. You have all kinds of problems in hospitals, nursing homes, the opiate promotional epidemic, the oil spills in the Gulf of Mexico and elsewhere, even dangerous toys. So when you have some activity in our society that is everywhere, every day, and you have a system of law that's designed to protect people, to say, if you're wrongfully injured, you can go to a lawyer on a contingent fee and file a lawsuit, ask for a trial by jury, and try to get compensation for your wage loss, medical expenses, pain and suffering, and in the process, disclose to the public the horrible situations in this industry, in that industry, or this government activity, and deter unsafe practices, because you have brought one, say, company to justice, produced a defective car or defective appliance, and other companies in the same business say, you know, we better clean up our act here. Otherwise, we're going to be hit with this kind of lawsuit or class action. Now, when you have something that's everywhere and every day, and it's visible to people, people see these wrongful injuries. They see their relatives coming back from factories with respiratory ailments. They see negligent car crashes. They see pollution. But there are also torts that they don't see. Say, what a surgeon who makes a mistake after he opens you up and then closes you. There are latent wrongful injuries as well. But anyway, you have something that's everywhere, every day. You have a system of law that goes back to medieval England, and it's not taught in the schools, just in the law schools. It's not taught to the people of all ages, backgrounds. This is not a partisan left, right, conservative, liberal. All the people bleed the same color. And it's not taught anywhere. If you were prone to conspiracies, you would say, how could that be? How could something that was designed to protect people, to give them compensation for sustaining their injuries over time and the care that they need, that might punish wrongdoers, bring them to justice, law and order, how come it's not taught? That's why the American Museum of Tort Law was established. That's the only tort museum in the world. People get wrongfully injured everywhere in the world, but somehow the legal professions around the world never saw fit to have a museum. There's even a bobblehead museum in Minnesota and all kinds of other museums, 32 timber and lumber museums, 15 medical museums. It's important to ask that question. Why? Especially since it's one of the great legacies from our forebears, from our ancestors. Trial by civil jury was established in 15th century England, got underway, because enough people of reason saw that when people hit each other or attacked each other and started cycles of revenge, maybe it's a good idea to bring their conflicts and their complaints to a court of law. And maybe it's a good idea that in addition to the judge, they would be tried by a jury of their peers, which is very reassuring to people who suspect backroom deals or corruption of government institutions. And so this trial by jury, this law of torts, was inherited and brought across the Atlantic. And it became an absolute pillar of the democracy that the early settlers wanted for themselves. I mean, when you look back to history of the revolt against King George, one of the major letters of grievance sent by the settlers or colonials to King George III, the number two complaint was he was trying to take away their right of trial by jury. Number one was no taxation without representation. Not only that, the early settlers really used their courts. They used their courts for a lot of their community needs. And so they didn't like the idea of the Tories and representing King George III controlling who was going to be their judges, their bailiffs, and their sheriffs. The right of trial by jury was prominently mentioned in the Declaration of Independence. It's quite interesting that very few people in this country have the Declaration of Independence on their wall framed. Of course, it had its warts. It was a time of slavery. Women didn't have many rights. African Americans didn't have many rights. Voters had to own property. But compared to the rest of the world, perhaps the exception of the Iroquois Confederacy, it was a tremendous leap forward in terms of its pretensions and principles. And having the Declaration of Independence on your wall, in your office, or at home is a great educational mechanism for your children. They'll say, what is that? And you start a discussion that's not on an iPhone in the virtual internet gulag. So we have on a museum the Declaration of Independence available in a strong tube that is suitable for framing. On one side, it has the old script, the way they wrote in the 18th century, and on the other side is the modern script. The second thing for public education is to start with the young. There's a lot of time wasted in elementary and high school. We all know that. It's a staggering amount of time, repetition, and all kinds of self-censorship. So the museum has developed a high school curriculum on torts, educating torts. What, you say? These aren't law students. That's correct. But you don't think they experience wrongful injury, witness it, hear about it, read about it, see it? It's all over. They experience it, whether it's close by in their community or around the country, in the world. And something youngsters experience are going to predispose them to becoming very interested in what could be done when they or their friends or relatives or neighbors are wrongfully injured. So this is on our website, tortmuseum.org. You can download it, go to your local high school and say, let's get serious here. There's too much bullying. There's a lot of street crime. But there's massively more preventable violence by corporate crime. Just think, 60,000 people die every year from work-related diseases, workplace-related diseases. About the same number die from air pollution. Those are EPA figures, OSHA figures. Here's the big one. A peer-reviewed Johns Hopkins School of Medicine reported a few years ago, and they said this was their most minimal estimate, that 5,000 people a week die in hospitals because of what they called, quote, preventable problems, end quote. That's 250,000 or more people who die from preventable problems. That didn't even include clinics or other medical establishments. Those are torts. Those are the product of negligence, carelessness, in some cases, even knowing and willful, in order to escape accountability or make more profit. So don't underestimate the intelligence of high school students. When you have low expectations, they may oblige you. When you have high expectations, they may surprise you. The next effort at education is by Richard Panchak's new book for the young. It's called Power to the People. All kinds of ages will benefit from this. A Young People's Guide to Fighting for Our Rights as Citizens and Consumers. That's also available on the museum website. My sister, Claire Nader, thought we should go to a younger age. She was always impressed by 9 to 12-year-olds, their imagination, their curiosity, their intellect, and also their demand for correcting things. They have a practical idealism, like on climate disruption. Why don't we deal with that problem, they say. We are children and you're not protecting us. That's increasingly the message that's coming from these aroused youngsters. And so Claire wrote a book called You Are Your Own Best Teacher, Sparking the Curiosity, Imagination, Intellect of Tweens. And in the book, she found the language to teach them about tort law. She found the language to teach them about contract law, because they have to click in and they're bound by all these fine print contracts. In fact, now these companies are trying to get 2-year-olds to have credit cards with all the fine print. So it's not something remote from their daily lives. Once we start with the young, maybe we'll start asking ourselves, what about this jury duty? What about this trial by jury? Why was it so big in our history so many decades ago? Because it's a major pillar of our democracy. Because unlike begging regulators to enforce the health and safety laws, unlike begging lawmakers taking campaign money to pass health and safety laws, you don't have to ask permission from anybody. If you're wrongfully injured, you can go to a lawyer, file a lawsuit. That's why it's called a pillar of our democracy. And that's why we have to ask ourselves, if it's in our Constitution, 7th Amendment, it's very simple the way it reads. It says, in suits at common law, that means judge law, not statutory law by legislatures, in suits of common law where the value in controversy will exceed $20, this is 1791, the right of trial by jury shall be reserved, and no fact tried by a jury shall be otherwise re-examined in any court of the United States than according to the rules of the common law, end quote. That's it. How many have read that? Well, judging by people prejudging jury duty, thinking it's a drag and it's an imposition, even though, as you heard, when they are engaged in jury duty, it's one of the most fascinating, inspiring experiences in their life. And they'll be the first people to tell you when they leave the jury room and the courtroom. However, the fact is that people do not appreciate the value of power that the jury system and the civil justice system put into their hands and into their minds, where they can judge the most powerful corporations and CEOs who haven't given a darn about the safety and health of people. And they pour the toxic carcinogenic stuff in the environment. And they increase global warming. And they refuse to recall defective products their own engineers have pointed out. They can be brought to deposition and they can be brought to the courtroom. And 12 ordinary people can become extraordinary. and render factual judgments. There's something else about jury duty. It's the only duty in the Constitution. We have a Bill of Rights. There's only one jury duty. It's not framed as a duty, but it's implied, because if it isn't a duty, you don't have any jurors, you don't have a jury system. And I think we should ask ourselves, can we really have rights enforced on our behalf if we don't exercise civic duties on our behalf? Now, given that background, the trial lawyers have a great opportunity. There are 60,000 active trial lawyers in the United States. Just think, they're well known in the community. They belong to various clubs. They're not known for being reticent verbally. If in 1 year, each one of them spoke to a total of 1,000 people. They went to some of the service clubs. They spoke to high school auditoriums, community colleges, civic gatherings. If each of those 60,000 just spoke to 1,000 people over the course of 12 months, they would reach 60 million people. That's a lot better than any advertisement. They've reached 60 million people, educating them about the power that they have in the civil justice system. That's not being done. Too many lawyers are in their own silos. They need to have a higher estimate of their own significance as officers of the court, looking out for the administration of justice. As you heard, the tort system, the civil justice system, is under severe attack. The corporations over the decades have managed to neutralize all too many legislators, all too many municipal elected officials, all too many regulators. That's created a lot of cynicism among people. Cynicism doesn't change anything. Skepticism does. But it's pretty hard to bribe a jury. And if you do, you're in real trouble. It's pretty hard to use big cash to rig a judge. It's a little easier to get conservative judges and corporate judges, to be sure, as they have in the federal judiciary. But generally speaking, the civil justice system is the most open, refereed, and accountable system of justice in the country. The trials are open to the press and to the citizenry. Each side can cross-examine each other and check each other. The appeals are open when they're argued before the appellate courts or the Supreme Courts. There's a transcript. It's pretty hard to get that kind of accountability for a regulatory agency or a legislature. So there are a lot of things that can be done to educate the public. Our museum has gone virtual. It is viewed now anywhere in the world. Just got a message from someone in Singapore saying, we should have a tort museum in Singapore. Yes, there should be more museums describing the laws of wrongful injury in various countries and cultures. Well, let me end on this note. We are expanding something we called Friends of the Tort Museum. We want them to be ambassadors to spread the word about the civil justice system, about how people can be empowered when they come home from a hospital and they have been subjected to some negligence and harm, for example. We'd also want them to go to the schools with all these materials especially the curriculum. So visit our tortmuseum.org and see how you can become a friend of the museum. One day before the pandemic, a retired high jurist from India, from Mumbai, was visited with his family. And he went through all the exhibits very meticulously, just like Justice Stephen Breyer did, by the way, when he visited the Tort Museum and called it, quote, an excellent educational institution, end quote. Coming at the end of his tour, this retired high jurist said to us, "Now I know what you're trying to do with this museum. You're trying to bring the law to the people, take it out of its jargoned obscurity and excessive complexity. Perfect. Now it's up to the people to take their law to produce a more just society." Thank you. Now, we have come to the conclusion. I'd like some questions, if you can. Melissa, are there any questions before
you
conclude?
Yes, there are a few questions for you. And we had a couple great comments, and I just wanted to share them with you. We have fantastic conference, Ralph, incredibly instructive on the essential importance of tort law. Inspiring and enlightening virtual program. My hope is legal professionals who often will not take a case will think more carefully after hearing this today. Your first question is, have you heard about the class action lawsuit in California regarding the employment agencies that racially discriminated against employees? If so, what is your opinion about employment lawsuits? Are they difficult to prove?
Yes, I heard about it in the newspapers. I don't have many of the details. It's an example of how tort law evolves. It breathes, it evolves, it tries to keep up, never keeps up with the new technologies like genetic engineering, artificial intelligence, nanotech. That's another subject. But the discrimination is usually under the civil rights laws rather than the tort laws, although the two are beginning to bridge each other, especially if the people are not only violating their civil rights, but it has a traumatic or defamatory impact on these people, workers in this context. And that would bring it under the tort law. It's interesting how most people don't realize that most crimes are also torts. So you have police brutality and the prosecutor doesn't prosecute, the families of the next of kin can bring tort lawsuits, and they've been doing it and getting substantial awards for further deterrence of such practices.
Excellent. What does one do if one comes across professional negligence, such as an attorney that fails to perform the simple task of following basic procedures to appoint an estate executor? Is that something that might be suitable for a tort case, or maybe the state bar?
Well, the answer is you should be able to go to the state bar regulatory agency, but it's dominated by lawyers in every state. And it doesn't do its job. I mean, I've had experiences where there's been a substantial evidence against malpracticing lawyers, and they don't even bother investigating. If there's pedophile, they're now beginning to investigate, let's say, or if there's looting of trust funds kept by lawyers in trust for their clients, they will often look into it. But just neglect, malpracticing is very difficult. On the other hand, there are some lawyers who specialize in suing malpracticing lawyers. And if you think you have a good case, every state has one or more lawyers who have become specialists in going after bad lawyers, malpracticing lawyers, negligent lawyers, incompetent lawyers. All professions have a few percentages of those kinds of unprofessional people, and they need to be held accountable. whether in accounting, medicine, engineering, or in this contest, lawyers.
Okay, your next question is, how does the use of tort law to address wrongful injury combine with political change to shift power so ordinary people have a more just social political order?
Well, that requires an elaboration by the questioner, but the I first thought the questioner was asking, how can successful tort suits affect regulatory standards and legislation by politicians? That has happened, by the way. My early experience is there were product liability cases against the tire companies in Akron in the early 1960s. They uncovered all kinds of inadequate testing of tires. They brought that evidence to the attention of Senator Nelson from Wisconsin, Gaylord Nelson. He introduced the tire safety law, which passed in the mid-60s. So disclosure by tort cases often leads to legislation and regulation that deal with the risk pattern on a wholesale basis, on an enforceable standard basis, rather than a case-by-case basis. As far as tort law affecting the elections and political activity, that has not been subject to much elaboration. It may someday, after all, the law of defamation is part of the law of torts. And while free speech is a protection against defamatory actions, there are limits, like malicious, willful, harmful speech.
I have a couple comments to share with you. You're an inspiration, Ralph. Thanks for the great program today. You're a legend, Ralph Nader. Nader. And a big thank you to everyone who worked to make this conference so great. I am an undergraduate student currently applying to law school for my honors thesis. I am preparing a project on torts reform and media. Through that research, I came across the museum's website, and I am so glad I did. Thank you for sharing all of this knowledge. The next question is...
That's very gratifying to hear that kind of feedback.
It is.
We hope more people will avail themselves of the resources, now online, virtual, the Tort Museum.
The next question is, why are we not more successful at suing and winning cases against chemical companies, not just winning damages, but banning their products once they've been proven harmful? Does it have to do with the captured agencies such as the EPA?
That's a very fundamental, important question, and it leads to a grim reality about tort law, that less than 5% of wrongfully injured people, I mean real substantially evidential wrongful injury, even sees a lawyer. Most plaintiffs don't even go to a lawyer. Some of them don't even know they're harmed because it's a long-range cancer impact from, say, an exposure to a chemical. And so tort law is grossly underutilized. That's something that even tort lawyers don't talk much about. It's grossly underutilized. 95% at least of all wrongful injury, and we're talking substantial injury here, never see a lawyer, much less a courtroom. Only 2% of the state budgets in the United States go to support the judiciary. Learned Hand, in a quote on the entrance to the Tort Museum, say, if you want to have a democracy, don't ration justice. So the chemical industry gets away with most of its inflicted harm. Number one, because it's hard often to prove it. It's an impact over time, unless you're in a chemistry lab by some drug company and you get a huge exposure. That's number one. Number two, they have corporate lawyers who know how to delay and engage in trials of attrition if you sue them. And remember, people can't wait the way corporations can wait. They can wait forever, and they can spend money on corporate lawyers and deduct them as expenses. But individual injured plaintiffs, they can't wait forever. So they grind these people into the ground and maybe settle for a trivial sum to get rid of the case. So this opens up a much greater window on the dark side of the civil justice system, how it's being degraded, atrophied, as the prior speakers alluded to, by corporate law firms who need to be more exposed. They're the brain trust for these corporations, the strategists, as well as indentured lawmakers who decide, they are going to decide what judges and juries do in specific cases, the only ones who hear, see, and evaluate the evidence in a courtroom, that these absentee campaign finance grease lawmakers are going to decide that someone who has a lifetime of pain and suffering can't recover more than $250,000 maximum, regardless of what the jury brings in. The judge has to reduce it to $250,000, say in a medical malpractice case. That's the situation in California and several other cases. So the questioner opens up a whole new series of events that we should hold for the Tort Museum in the coming future.
Excellent. We also have another thank you, Ralph. I attended the first two seminars, and with the knowledge I gained, I have been able to support environmental issues and the horrors of dangers of brownfields and industry manufacturers polluting our environment. Thank you. The next question is, what would you suggest for people who are struggling to get a lawyer to represent them?
Well, the usual answer, you go to public legal aid, but they mostly take criminal cases. And if you have a civil case for damages, they'll recommend you find a tort lawyer. Okay, so it's hard to find tort lawyers in difficult cases. Some of them are willing to take these cases, like Greg Kafuri takes almost impossible cases against police brutality, which are hard cases to win, needless to say. But other lawyers say it's not economically feasible. We don't charge by the hour. It's a contingent fee. We don't think we can recover after hundreds of hours of work. Sorry, we can't take your case. I would suggest that you go to a local law school and ask to see the tort law professors or a particular legal clinic. There may be a legal clinic. I know one law school has 30 different legal clinics on all kinds of justice issues. So you can try that. But I get some real heartrending letters from people who try and try and try, and they just can't get a lawyer. Of course, there are some cases that you don't have the adequate evidence for it, even though you believe you've been wrongfully harmed. Those are the real torturous situations. A lot of them are worker compensation cases.
We have a comment, which is great. Watching this program made me realize that I underestimated how important tort law is. This program has really opened my eyes. Thank you. Do you have any thoughts about the Alex Jones case and judgment? Did it get more media attention than other more important cases involving injury? And do you think it's changed the public's perception on tort law?
Oh, this is a great pioneering case brought by lawyers in Connecticut, which is the Constitution state. Alex Jones really went overboard. He reached millions of people. He was defaming these bereaved parents in Sandy Hook who lost their little children, saying it was a fake, it was a hoax. They were paid to do that, it was staged. Clearly one of the most spectacular prevarications in public history in the United States. And he was getting away with it, and he was selling all kinds of things in his business and getting away with it. The legislature wasn't doing anything. The courts weren't doing anything. And these lawyers said, you know, defamation is one of the tenets of tort law, and this is malicious defamation. This is way beyond any rights of free speech. This is malicious defamation. Well, Oliver Wendell Holmes once said, your right of free speech stops when you falsely shout fire in a crowded theater. memorable phrase for law students to recall. So they brought this case, and it wasn't easy. Alec Jones had a lot of lawyers who could delay and postpone and rebuff, but they got a verdict of almost $1 billion very recently. He's worth a lot of money, but not quite that much. And I think that is another example of how tort law evolves to rise to the occasion of new circumstances. And Josh Koskoff, of course, mentioned earlier out of Bridgeport, a youngish trial lawyer, brought the case on behalf of other parents at Sandy Hook against the Remington Weapons Company. Why, someone would say, they didn't do the shooting, but they had the most targeted promotional materials geared to a demographic of young, troubled men. I mean, the promotional micro data of these companies is something to behold. And that became the core. And Remington finally had to settle for about $73 million.
A couple of follow-ups with the Alex Jones. One is, do you think that the Alex Jones verdict then opens the door for other disinformation, maybe media outlets, that type of thing?
Well, this was probably the easiest of the grossest defamation claims that could be made. I mean, there aren't that many people at Alex Jones's level of basically characterizing a real tragedy, you know, a documented tragedy, a visual tragedy people saw, experienced, and calling it a fake. Now, you call an election a fake and you undermine companies that are servicing the electoral machinery and you engage in what tort law calls willful interference with a disadvantageous economic relationship. It's a mouthful. And so Dominion Company out of Canada has filed a suit against some of the Fox newscasters who defamed the company. They basically said the company was engaging in rigging elections or falsifying results or whatever their software touched on. And that's another example that's going to pioneer the law of defamation. Usually corporations don't win defamation suits. There's always a danger, you know, that tort law can be taken to harmful extremes. As I said, it's very refereed. The judges control the courtroom. They can have a notwithstanding the jury verdict if the jury goes off the reservation. It's a very rigorous, accountable system subject to appeal, but there are people who can abuse it and they can stifle free speech, file defamation act against someone who doesn't have all that money to defend themselves. So we all have to be very alert, especially lawyers who are officers of the court, to curb those ruinous misuses of tort law who may get through some of these preliminary judicial screens. But even if they're thrown out of court, it's an unsettling experience for a defendant who believes themselves to be innocent.
Sure. We have another follow-up to that, which is Paul Pelosi was assaulted by someone who seemed to be engaged in Alex Jones's conspiracy theories and violent rhetoric. Would he have any standing to sue?
You mean Paul Pelosi?
Yes.
Well, he'd obviously have standing to sue his assailant. The question is, would he have standing to sue someone prominent who incited violence in a general way without saying, well, I want you to go to Paul Pelosi in San Francisco? That's a matter of what's called proximate evidence. In other words, how close was the incitation to the sequence? That's what the January 6th House Committee is working on now with Donald Trump, He incited the crowd, said, I'm going to be with you, and used all kinds of aggressive wordings and phrases. And the question is that a tort? Well, Congressman Smallwell from California filed a tort suit. He was in the building at the time. The crowd roared in, endangered members of Congress. They were later heard to say or deposed to say that they were taking their orders from the boss, that it was Donald Trump who encouraged them to do all this and to be very vigorous and stop the steal. This wasn't just a crowd going to express their opinion. It was a crowd urged by the President of the United States to engage in an action in addition to words or speech, in an action to overturn the certification of the election by then Vice President Pence. And so that case is in the courts, and it's a tort case against Donald J. Trump. Take a while to work itself through if it isn't subject to an approved motion to dismiss. So it's all a question of how sequentially you can prove the incitement to the tortious activity, to the wrongful injury or damage.
Why can't I find a civil rights attorney in Connecticut, or the entire nation, in fact, to sue the government?
Well, that's another problem with the tort system. There's something called sovereign immunity. The king can do no wrong. It came from England. The king can do no wrong was part of British law, sovereign immunity. And that's one obstacle to suing the government to hold them accountable. Let's say they threw a court case, total malpractice by conservative or negligent government attorneys against a corporation. Or let's say a defense corporation produced a defective helicopter, which killed Marines, it's an actual case. And the bereaved families will sue the manufacturer of the helicopters. And the helicopters have invoked the doctrine where they say, no, we are so much part of the government contracting that we are protected by the sovereign immunity of the government. Now, some judges have said, nonsense. We're going to pierce that veil. And they allowed the case to proceed. But these corporations are so close to the government now, the military-industrial complex and other contracting corporations. So much government is contracted out to private corporations. Look at Medicare Advantage, which we call Medicare Disadvantage. Half of the elderly almost now are in these corporate health insurance plans paid for by the taxpayer, run by Aetna, Cigna, United Healthcare Corporation, and so on. It's hard to tell the difference. And to make matters worse, these companies are now putting the mantle of government immunity against tort cases over themselves. So that's going to be a legislative battle, not just the court battle, to say, look, you are private profit-making corporations. You're going to be held accountable. You're not going to hide behind any kind of government immunity. Now, piercing government immunity is subject to whether the government did something that was ministerial or discretionary. And without going into all that detail, a very persistent lawyer can try to find just the type of government behavior that is on the outer edges of immunity or way apart from any immunity, and the people in the government can be held accountable as individuals. To make a agency accountable is a whole other topic.
I'm curious about a tort towards people that drove the allegation of election fraud, causing millions of voters like you and me to perhaps lose our voting rights as states strip them away.
Well, that would have to be a very, let's say, imaginative theory. As I say, tort law usually involves injuries that are physical. Mental injuries are harder to get under tort law, although not unheard of. That's called pain and suffering, right? That's mental. That's not dollars and cents. There was a time 80, 90 years ago when you couldn't get compensation for pain and suffering. You just got compensation for your wage loss or your medical expenses. It's another example of the evolving nature of tort law. When it comes to elections, there are other remedies, of course. There are civil rights remedies, civil liberties remedies, stifling free speech. When you vote, you know, that's an expression of free speech under the First Amendment. But to turn it into tort law, there might have to be some physical dimension to it, such as that the Trumpsters want tough looking guys to come down to the precincts now around the country in November election and sort of glare at people supposedly looking for voter fraud. And in almost half the states now, you can have a handgun permit. You can have a handgun possession without a permit, no permit whatsoever. Now that may lead to a level of intimidation. If there is a fracas and injury, that would come right under tort law.
Okay, and that wraps up our questions for this afternoon. Do you have any other thoughts, Ralph, that you wanted to share?
Yes, it's the thoughts that move into action. Viewers, kind viewers, you know, inspiration is not perspiration. It's just an engine for civic perspiration, which can also be a lot of fun. So I urge you to go to the next level. Probably the best collection of tort books on famous trials and tort law and history are in this American Museum of Tort Law. Go to tortmuseum.org and you'll see the various offerings there. And the second, to start discussions in your community, it's pretty good to have a t-shirt that Tort Law Gift Store offers. And they say, what is that? Or a button or a hat. So they're not just mementos, they're also discussion starters. And thirdly, you know, I would say most Americans underutilize their civic power. So when you are asked to meet a candidate for office, and that's happening a lot in the next few days, and all they want to do is shake your hands and then go to the next handshake, hold on to their hands until they answer your question. That's a lesson my mother taught me and her other children when she met Prescott Bush, the senator from Connecticut, the grandfather of the two Bushes. And there used to be devastating floods in our community. And one way to make sure the community was protected is to have a dry dam above the river. And the state of Connecticut would never get around to it. Flood after flood. All kinds of communities in the Naugatuck Valley or some pretty onrushing rivers would be flooded with hurricanes. And so she went to a reception when he was running for re-election and got in line, came up to him and said, he shook her hand and she said, Senator Bush, I want you to make a dry dam happen and to save lives and property in our whole area of Connecticut. And he smiled and he tried to extricate his hand and she wouldn't let go until he said, Mrs. Nader, I'll try to do that. And he did. And a dry dam was built and never had another flood. So use your underutilized civic power. And I have always said it only takes 1% of engaged citizens in 425 congressional districts, 1%, that's 2.5 million adults, who get together and start civic accountability groups for Congress, for their two senators and representatives. They change the whole scene in Capitol Hill doesn't matter how powerful the corporations are, doesn't matter how much money they throw into the campaigns. There's one thing senators and representatives want more than money. That's your vote. If you make it dear and targeted and focused, and 1% representing majority opinion on so many left-right issues that are converging but never publicized in our country, like health insurance for all and living wage and cracking down on corporate crooks and so on, the corporations can't handle it. They don't have the votes. So that's perhaps the overriding lesson of this excellent session this afternoon. And we'll have more events that Melissa Byrd will inform you about. And I want to thank John Richard and Hannah and Melissa and Cash and all the rest of the people who made this possible, in addition to the presentations by the practitioners that you heard. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ralph. And I want to thank everyone for attending our event. We hope you're walking away more informed and with a stronger interest in the benefits of tort law and the protection it lends its citizens and how it makes our communities safer. It's important that we remember that we are all public citizens and that it's our duty to remain civically involved to protect our democracy. So thank you again. I hope that you can stop by in person. We are located at 654 Main Street in Winsted, Connecticut. And please keep up with our event schedule through our website, www.tortmuseum.org. Thanks again and have a great afternoon.